we are here to demonstrate the linkages, the relevance of heritage and culture for thriving cities of today. And why in the context of smart cities? So the smart cities mission really provides a whole new set of opportunities to test and try new tools, new approaches, and a significant budget has been dedicated to that. Nevertheless, despite this, although some smart cities are heritage cities and they've integrated heritage to an extent into their smart city plans, but we believe that more can be done. And let us discuss today what exactly can be done, what are the benefits a city can harness on heritage and culture, and how to unlock these benefits. So since our topic is achieving SDGs in Asian cities, let me start with our host, Vikas Kanungo, and ask you, Vikas, the following. So we know that Asian countries are quite committed to implementing the SDG targets, achieving them. And we have also realized that achieving the Sustainable Development Goals targets actually comes to localizing SDGs. And in this respect, Asia urbanizing so fast, and India in this respect as well, localizing SDGs also strongly means implementing SDGs in cities. So in this respect, how do you think heritage revival can contribute to achieving SDGs in Asian cities?
When we talk about SDGs, achieving sustainable development goals, we are achieving them for people. And the conference is Smart Republic. The Republic, by definition, is of the people, by the people, for the people. And even in our e-governance projects, we initially started saying they should be citizen-centric, but we soon realized that what is citizen-centric was also being decided by the people who were designing the projects rather than the citizens talking themselves. So from that, we moved to a concept called citizen-driven e-governance projects. But smart cities projects now give us an opportunity to do something called cyber-physical integration, which means you also make analog components smart. And if we have to do it from a citizen-driven perspective, then I think the cultural heritage of a country or the uniqueness of each city basically plays a big role. Each city can aspire to become smart using the tools which are available, not only protect their heritage, but also preserve their heritage for our future generations. So I guess like digital development, the culture and heritage also are the goals which are cross-cutting across all the SDGs.
So with that, I would like to turn to Divya Gupta and ask you first, why do you think we haven't harnessed enough on the potential of heritage? Or in other words, what are the challenges that maybe have stopped cities to harness on heritage assets as much as it could have been possible?
Culture is said to be the fourth pillar of sustainability. But unfortunately, in our context, we somehow lack confidence towards heritage. A lot of reliance is on the engineering solutions, in spite of immense solutions that are based in heritage, which are far more cost effective, far more sustainable. So I think the first challenge is that we have to maybe change this mindset that heritage is something old, but it is very, very useful for today. So we have to generate more confidence towards heritage solution. The second is, which is perhaps linked to the first, it's always becomes an extra optional sector. And because of which, I think the systems are also aligned to make it like a passive participant. And of course, end of the day, the heritage gives not only identity, but I think it contributes to a better living standard and enhances the city life and its, I think, competitiveness within the, maybe even the socioeconomic and economic scenarios.
So when we are in a developing context of many Asian countries, and India in particular, we see that there are tremendous housing, infrastructure, basic services needs So we need to build a lot. And on the other side, we see there are these benefits of heritage, of reviving heritage, of investing into heritage. Could you please comment a little bit on how possibly we can reconcile the two? Are they kind of opposing each other, or could they be seen as complementary?
It's true that India and a lot of the developing world requires tremendously fast-paced infrastructure. But as a wise man said, speed is immaterial if you're going in the wrong direction. So, look, there are really two ways that I think of as the ways people approach this problem. There is the conventional, for want of a better word, let me call it capitalistic approach, which says that we can do some development if we have sufficient resources, sufficient money, and we throw that at the problem. Actually, you can hardly solve anything at all with that approach. That is the approach that is favored by a large number of technologists because it gives them jobs, frankly. And yet, if you take that approach, you will forever be stuck with the kind of situation that I find in one of the NCR cities where I live, where there is a constant denudation of traditional water harvesting structures. And typically, you will find new malls and new hospitals and buildings coming up over lands, which were actually, in a traditional society, meant for soaking in the rainwater, with the consequent creation of floods every time it does rain just a bit. And of course, everybody wonders why the flooding is more now, but the answers are there for everybody to see. So it's a question of what we want to do with our cities, and it's not just a technical economic question, and unless you can enlarge that, we'll never really be able to solve even our housing problems, even our speed problems.
Let us turn to Suparna Bala in this respect. So we kind of mapped out why heritage can be an asset. Could you talk to us about a successful example of how heritage has been unlocked in an Indian or an Asian cities?
We tried to do something like this when we were supposed to do a culture report on Varanasi, you know, when this whole Varanasi revival started. And we went about it with great earnest, and we started thinking about culture, and we realized culture is something that you cannot measure. And if you can measure it, it's not culture. So that's the first problem. The measure of tourism was supposed to be the measure of a culture. Now that's an impossible thing. You can't connect the two. It's not even viable. So my first point is, acknowledge your reality. Now, I don't mean you have to become Buddhist, but I do mean that you have to acknowledge Google Earth. Most of our master plans are fairly outdated. Even the one which is coming out for Delhi in 2020 uses data and census, which is of 2011, to map it. There is no real shared mapping in the country. It's something that's absolutely appalling, especially in areas of great heritage value. We are always told it's fantastic, this heritage value. But you'd be surprised to see how they are not clearly mapped. Number three, you think you've got it by mapping it. Let me tell you, you still have to get it. Because it's not smart yet. It's only physically mapped. You need to do social mapping. Then you reach number four, where you overlay the two. Now that's the real cocktail. And you have to be an expert bartender to do this. Because you can't do it all on your own. You have to get in people from other sort of walks of life. It's not about the planner, according to me. I mean, we saw that. It was about getting in the historian, the social scientist, the economist, everybody over there to do this analysis. Then you can arrive at a brief. Now, most people confuse a brief, at least I think, with what they need to do. The brief is not what you need to do. The brief is why you need to do it. And that question is a tougher question to answer. Why are we doing this? Once you've answered that question, go ahead and do it. Start with a surgical strike. Pick something small. Once you've built that, take groups, little groups of people, start the advocacy. Go and see. See, this is what can happen. This is the possibility. Share the possibilities. Once people have seen that, come back, revise the plan. you know, revise the ideas based on this. After all, it's feedback. It belongs to the people, right? Republic. And then put it in the plan. Go ahead and make 3 such more projects. We can't build cultural sustainability on the physical aspect of our cities. Culture has to be sustained through a very simple thing. Anthropologically, it's always been done by the story. So we have to create a filter where we are actually able to filter the right stories. We have to connect with the stories. So I gave this example of Chanderi, you know, when I was speaking sometime earlier, and I said, you know, it's like I have a sari which is given by my grandmother, which is made in Chanderi, and has motifs. If only I knew then that it was, those motifs are there in the architectural palace in Chanderi itself, where the king built this grand sort of space to commemorate a victory. And today when I wear the sari, I'm also sort of connecting with that palace and that architecture in Chanderi. The stories are equally valuable.
And with that, I would like to turn to Ashok Bilal and seek your insights on, do you think, and what if yes, what are these lessons we can draw from the way people used to plan cities in India, people used to design cities in India, people used to build cities, neighborhoods, and houses. What are the urban development models that possibly could inspire us today?
Looking at the environmental footprint of traditional old city structures, cities that were built in the 16th, 17th, and 18th centuries, and many of the thriving cities in Europe today, the core of those cities or even quite a lot of the extension of those cities have followed the same principles of what we call a tight-knit city where people live generally quite close to the ground, 2, 3, 4 stories high. It now gives a lot of priority to pedestrianization, and which is then supported by a strong public transport system. This is the nature of the fabric of the traditional city, which has been shown to have the least carbon footprint compared to any other form of modern urbanism anywhere in the world. If we are talking about an incredible pace of urbanization and growth of cities, this shall be achieved while serving our commitment to the Paris Accord and also while using processes that support the Sustainable Development Goals. If we're going to do that, what we find is the low-rise, high-density city meets the necessary imperatives. You have to start with affordability. You have to have a form of city which is low carbon. You have to have ways of building that are resource efficient, of land as well as materials. This formula, these 3 circles in the Venn diagram, when they overlap, and you see that triangle marked in the center, that is the traditional form of the city.
Gajan, you've conducted a number of projects here in India and across the world as well. What are the ways of kind of forming a modern design language today which would tailor to the local context, would contribute to the identity, to the kind of unique value of the city? Could you please share some insights on this point?
I am coming here from Pondicherry and they're from Iceland. And there we, in Pondicherry, have an architectural office. We always put a special emphasis on the individual and the individual experience. And without the individual, if you forget him, you never make a good structure. So friendly design is always at our base. I think anything not made with beauty, anything that does not have a heart or soul, will never work successfully as an architect. And here, we are dealing so much with technical solutions to the problems of the world and the future of cities, but we also have to think about what gives meaning to the structure, what makes them comfortable. The first one I'm showing is, which is up on the screen now, and this building, which is now under construction in Shillong, up in Meghalaya. There, we went into linguistic analysis, the word Meghalaya, as many may know, comes from Sanskrit, and it means an abode or dwelling in the sky. It has 4 major auditoriums, and all of very special nature, but there's something we favor very much, which is that of multi-use. In a way, we saw this building as an opportunity to embrace the musical tradition of the state. So the building itself has two open arms, which then again, according to the natural slide of the site, creates an amphitheater for 20,000 people. So here you can see in this image how kind of natural metaphors of rivers and lakes and musical instruments, et cetera, come to fuel and be the source of imagination for the making of the building. This is a project we favor multi-use very much. There is an elementary school here in South Extension owned by the and run by the Sikh community. It houses 1,000 people today. So this is sort of something that's unconsidered now. So in a way, this is, I would say, trying to be a smart thinking to make something, get something more out of a structure than simply is foretold.
In fact, many of you may have found a brochure called Seher Asia, which stands for a program, Sustainable Cities Through Heritage Revival, which is a program to which, in a way, all of us are connected. INTAC has been one of the incubators of this program, which basically helps cities in Asia, Indian and other Asian cities, to unlock the value of heritage assets in their cities. I would like to turn to Vikas once again to look into more detail on what can we actually harness from digital technologies. We have seen a number of examples where digital technologies actually serve and unlock the value of heritage. Could you please share some of these ideas with us?
How many of you would have observed that there is somebody sitting in this room who is recording all the sessions, all the discussions which are happening in his unique way? So if I can just ask camera people to switch. So we have this friend of ours who, when he came 1 month back to one of the workshops in World Bank, and he was standing on the corner of a room and on the flip charts trying to record whatever being talked. And this actually, all of you who have this capacity building report would have seen, this is part of our report. And here it is in a month's time, he is here, he is not drawing on the flip chart anymore, he's drawing it directly on a pad. You can see it on the screen, say for example, on this session, what is it that was discussed during this session is on your screens. The entire discussion of the session in the form of one diagram, but also preserve it for future usage. So what I want to say to the panelists on this session is that protecting heritage, keeping your uniqueness of culture, and digital technologies do not work at cross purposes. Digital technologies are just enablers, and the use of those for achieving the goals you're wanting to achieve is limited by your own imagination. So if your imagination is such that you see them at cross purpose, that's how they look. But if you can imagine them to be the means to achieve your goal of preserving your heritage, then they could be very valuable.
So imagination is our limit. So on this high note, to go and look into your local context, into your heritage assets, and we're always here to help, if anything. Thank you very much for being with us.